Hello and welcome to Some Assembly Required. Parts of this video were filmed and edited while I'm recovering from the coronavirus, so I hope my brain fog didn't hurt the quality. In the last video, we got text output working for the Apple II clone we're building on an FPGA. This time, I'd like to get keyboard input working as well. In the previous video, I mentioned that the C0 page is reserved for memory mapped I/O, typically called soft switches on the Apple, and that we're not going to implement it for now. Well, for now has now passed. It's time to implement soft switches. At least, two specific soft switches. The Apple keyboard is controlled by two soft switches. C000 returns the last pressed key. By working from monitor, it will always be 0D, which means carriage return, because that's the last key I press in order to display the value. The value returned will have bit 7 clear if we've already seen and processed it, and bit 7 set if it's a new key not yet processed. Marking the key as processed is done by reading C010. So merely reading C010 causes the value returned by C000 to change from bit 7 set to bit 7 clear. This way the Apple can tell if we press the same key twice. Great! So how do we implement it? This is the soft switches module. It gets the bottom 8 bits of the address bus. Since it's just a single page, it doesn't need the top bits, it just needs a single enable bit. It gets the CPU clock, which is a 1 MHz clock, but also the system clock, which is a 50 MHz clock. The reason for that is so it can put a UART in it. We need a UART receiver inside the I/O module so we can know what key was pressed. The module itself is not particularly complicated at this point. We do need a state machine around clearing the 7th bit of C000, because the key is received from the UART, which works on the system clock, whereas the clear is received from the CPU, which works on the CPU clock. Bridging that gap required a small state machine. Otherwise, we just wait for the UART to say we have data ready, and set the last key pressed register to bit 7 set and the rest from the UART. If we see that the CPU requested to clear the 7th bit, we do it here. Let's see how that works. And we have input. Of course, we don't have backspace. We actually have to hit Control H. Much better. So yeah, we're pretty much done, right? So why is there so much time left on this video? Let's fill the time by looking at some of the routines we've gone through. So the boot started the boot vector, which points to FA62. There we have clear the decimal flag, a few jump subroutine, load A from 0 page 58, compare Y to AD, invalid opcode. What is going on here? That can't be right, can it? It isn't right. Something in the disassembly went wrong. AD was supposed to be disassembled to load A from absolute address C058. Instead, it got disassembled to load A from 0 page. What is going on? At this point, there are two scenarios we can suspect. Either there's a bug in the auto-start ROM of the Apple II. Let me just give it the score of unlikely. Or there's a bug in our implementation. Most likely, the CPU. Of course, just knowing there's a bug is not helpful to us. We want to see where that bug is. So what we want to do is run the disassembly routine and figure out what's the difference between the correct and our incorrect implementation. This is the subroutine that parses the instruction and tells us how long it is, something that we know for a fact is incorrect when running through our CPU. What I did next was to copy the offending code into the test program I used to test the CPU. Here it is, same address. Of course, some adjustments were needed, which means we can now run the program on the test harness and collect the information about how an authoritative run is supposed to look like. If you don't know what that is, there's a link in the description to a video describing exactly what this system does. With the test plan locked in place, we can now run the simulation and see where we're failing. We can see that we failed at address F8F2. We can now begin to trace the program back and see where things went wrong. Last opcode we ran was in address F891, which was load A format-X. And we know that we expected to read from F8F2 and instead read from F8B2, which means X has the wrong value. The opcode we're trying to disassemble is A9. We should be load A immediate and instead registers as 3 question marks. Now we need to find this instruction in the official source code. So it's this one. It's an F89D. We can now create a program on the emulator, which disassembles incorrectly on our machine, and then ask to disassemble it while setting a breakpoint to the command that went wrong. And our breakpoint triggered. So this is a load A from address indexed by X, and X is 41. In our implementation, X is 01. So we need to understand why X got the wrong value. The command immediately before that is transfer AX. So what we really want to track is when A changes its value. That happens here, which is logical shift right.
In preparing this video, I've skipped about certain details. These include how I found the source code for the disassembly routine, how I found which subroutines there failed to work correctly, as well as some of the steps in finding the precise opcode that doesn't work. I'm thinking of making a patron-only video that will include those missing parts. I'd love to hear from current and future patron supporters whether they'd be interested to see it. Which brings us to the obvious next point. I have a patron page. Despite the relative low-key announcement, I even have a couple of supporters already. So my very warm thanks goes to John Bannion, who is and shall forever remain my very first supporter, and also to Michael Dernboss, who did not send me his picture. Even so, I still love you both.
So RotateRight got the same input and issued a different output. Let's see which one is correct. So 5-4 shifted right by 1 bit is 2A. However, that depends on the state of the carry. If the carry flag is set, we need to set bit 7, in which case it's supposed to be AA. So it seems like our CPU doesn't shift in the carry with the rotate right. Let's look at the command's implementation. We're looking for rotate right of accumulator, and the carry source is set to ALU carry source 0. That's incorrect. It should be carry source carry. So let's rerun the simulation and see if that solved it. And it did. Let's test the code with a fix on the board again. And it works. We fixed the bug in the CPU and now disassembly works correctly. Ooh. Now with that, we're theoretically done, but there was one more thing I just couldn't resist doing. I added a speaker output to the main module. I had to give up on one of the debug lines in order to do that. And I connected it to a new port I added to the soft switches module. I assigned a pin and a voltage level to it. And all that's really left is any access to C03 anything will toggle the speaker state. And that's really all I did. About 10 lines in total. All we need to do now is connect the speaker to the device. Strangely, the only speaker I have came from an actual Apple II. Program the FPGA and we have sound. Let's press Ctrl G a few times. Something doesn't sound right. So our system produces a beep that is just slightly lower pitched than the real Apple II. But looking at the hardware, there's hardly anything that could cause this. All our speaker hardware does is toggle a bit if a certain address is accessed.
Assuming the CPU clock is the same, there's no way that this will produce different frequencies. Of course, this assumption is exactly what doesn't work. Our board runs off a 50 MHz clock and gets divided by 50 to produce a 1 MHz clock. It turns out that the original Apple II actually ran on 1.022727 MHz. This means that the Apple II is 2.3% faster than our implementation. It might surprise you that we can even hear a 2% frequency difference, but it shouldn't. The entire scale, a single octave, means multiplying the frequency by 2. An octave is divided to 12 halftones that are evenly spaced on the logarithmic scale. This means that each halftone is 6% higher frequency than the previous halftone. So a 2.3% difference is a third of a halftone, something which we're completely capable of hearing. So what we need to do is supply our CPU with the correct frequency, 1.022727 MHz. To get such uneven numbers, we're using dedicated circuitry on the FPGA to produce given clock speeds from other clock speeds. Opening the clocking wizard, we can tell it that we're giving it a 50 MHz clock, and our output clock needs to be 1.022727. Sadly, that's too slow. If you multiply by a power of 2, the division later will be easier, so we'll multiply by 16. And that works better. Except, it's not perfect. We are asking for 16.363632, and we're getting 16.363634. Since that's an error of 0.00005%, I think we can live with this. First of all, the system clock goes to a clock generator, which produces our 16.3 MHz. The locked signal indicates that the output clock is stable, and we're using that in order to determine the reset state. So as long as the clock generator is not stable, the CPU gets a reset. Then we're fitting that into the divide by 16 module. That's just a 4-bit counter that outputs the last bit as the output. That effectively divides by 16. Most of everything else remains as it was. We're still using the base clock for the UART, but this time we're using the 16 MHz clock rather than the 50 MHz clock. This has to do with metastability and clock domains, but I'll maybe discuss it at some later video. This means we need to feed a different divider for the UART, but otherwise this area remains pretty much as it was before. Let's program it and see what happens. Okay, so just as a reminder, this is how it sounds before we reflash. Now let's flash it. Phew! Okay, that took longer than expected, but we can finally call our Apple II clone booting and working. Thank you for watching.